What do you know about trading? We'll talk about it on this episode of the MindDog TV podcast. This episode is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform. Avoid the mystery of one-sided deals. Connect with Fundwise to get the very best funding you can qualify for fast. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. It's easy. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You did hear me correctly. I did say start or grow your business. If you don't have a business yet, but you got a solid business plan, they can help you get funding. Get the best funding you can qualify for. Their strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, and bridge loans. They work with real estate, startups like I already mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really easy. Just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddog. That's apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Get money for your business now. Apply.fundwise.com/minddog.
Is everybody ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show?
No.
Start the clock.
I guess it's now what I am. And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the MindDog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here. As always, we're going to talk about trading tonight and how we can, a bulletproof method for investing and trading, something I'm interested in. I know you're interested in, but this show is for the grown-ups. And one thing I have to say is I can't overstate how it's just magical that we can talk around the world in video and audio at the same time, very clearly. It's just a miracle. It's a miracle. And we do it often. Tonight, we're going to be talking all the way around the world again to Australia and doing it, hopefully, technology will hold up with some clarity and great picture and sound for you. My guest tonight is Louise Bedford. She's one of Australia's most compelling speakers on the share market. And I think that's what they call the stock market. You know, language differences here. As well as being in the market for over 30 years, she has trained thousands of people to maximize their own trading potential. She is a behavioral finance expert and has degrees in psychology and business. And who doesn't need a good psychologist? and has done the hard yards. Now, that's got to be an Australian term. I'm sure I didn't write that word. The hard yards in the share market. So you can shortcut your way to success by following her methods. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your minds, open your ears, and help me welcome in Louise Bedford from all the way from Australia. Louise, welcome.
Oh, it's fantastic to be here. Wonderful to be all around the world. You're so right. Miracle of technology.
And we take it lightly. Like I've done this 100 times now, and I don't want to start taking it for granted, but it is amazing. And sometimes the connection between here and where you are is better than here and 10 miles away.
How about that?
I have no idea why that is, but we're thankful for it. And otherwise I would not be able to have conversations with people like you and Chris Tate and so forth. So I'm very grateful for it. So thank you for coming.
Oh, it's wonderful. Do you know, Matt, that interview that you did with my business partner, Chris Tate, is one of our most popular interviews of all time. I've got a thing for bald men. What can I say? So both of you, I live on in my heart.
Well, thank you very much for that. That's very... it makes me feel good that people like it, but I think the reason they probably like it is because they can see, especially if they are looking to learn, they can see, well, I'm better than that guy. Anyway, how are you feeling? I want to know, because last time you weren't with us because you were not well. I just want to, and yes. I don't want to get too personal or dig too deep, but are you okay?
You can ask anything. I've just come out of a two-year stint of being unable to talk. I've had to relearn how to speak again. Last month was the first month that I've been able to do interviews again. And it has been a long process, my friend, involving speech therapy and mindfulness and many ENT visits. So I'm so happy to be here. I'm so excited. You're such an inspiration to so many. So to be interviewed by you is just wonderful.
You gotta stop, because I'm not good with compliments.
I know, I love it. That's why I'm putting you on the spot.
Well, it's great to hear that you've recovered from that. It sounds terrible. And again, I don't like to be probing, but that sounds like an awful experience. I know a lot of people who listen to me talk wish that would happen to me. But I'm glad you recovered and glad to have you here. Now, I want to talk about, because after Chris was on the program last time, I enrolled in a brief mini course that you guys put out for beginners like me, audio lessons. And as you can see behind me, I'm not a grown-up. There's guitars on behind me, not degrees in quantum physics or any of this kind of stuff. I'm not a grown-up. So as I was listening to it, I said, you know what? I kept telling myself, I can do this. And then a voice would come into my head and said, who are you kidding? This is for grown-ups. You're not a grown-up. This is not you. You don't care about money. You care about making music and having fun and doing all these childish things. So I think that's the biggest hurdle for people. Can we talk about that feeling of this is not for me because I'm just not good with money, or money is not my thing, and I'm not intelligent enough for this, or any of those doubts that kind of slip in?
We put up so many hurdles for ourselves, far more than anybody in our lives put up. One of the things I think we need to be careful with is our identity. Now, you are the music guy. You've got that fantastic language in your background. So you've been able to learn one skill. It's a matter of generalizing that ability to learn another skill. Now with the pandemic, we're still in lockdown here. Can you believe it? We are in the city that has been in the longest lockdown in the world. We won. So a dubious honour. I think we have to be very careful about who we think we are. There's a concept called identity foreclosure. Now, this is a fascinating idea where it starts to really cement itself when we are teenagers. If you think of your teenagers where they're very fixated on one thing, so my girl is fixated on Minecraft, for example. She just loves Minecraft, can't get enough of it. So that has become her identity. And for us to mature as adults, we need to be able to generalize across a few different identities. And in fact, everything that I can see and everything is telling me that the people who had the most identities that they could draw from, whether they're a father, whether they're a share trader, whether they're a musician, the most identities wins, because when one identity is letting you down, you can push forward into another. Not only do you have a friendship group that can help you, because usually identities come along with friendship, but also you're able to be plastic enough to mold into different identities. And that emotional and mental flexibility can really save you in so many ways. So none of us need to be stuck in our own ways. One of the guys that I trained, he was 98 years old when he passed. He was a full-time trader for the final 12 years of his life. He'd never traded until then. So I love that about training. Well,
that's inspiring. Okay, I'll go with you there. So my identity has always been, and people know this because in my documentary, I talk about it. I put the clips out there anyway, the full documentary is not yet. People think, wait. That I've always had this identity of purposely not growing up, and you talked about that identity as you becoming an adult and stuff, and I think I purposely avoided that. But let's move on from here, because there's a part of what you talk about that I think is important, and I think it's important for people to understand, and it's a hard segue for me. But first of all, I think that In a married couple, not both people need to be the money person.
Mm, correct.
Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. And in fact, very rarely do spouses grow at the same speed. Right. I just caught up with a girlfriend yesterday. She was saying how she's the one that's out in front and he's the one that's sort of lagging behind. I think the key with that dynamic, though, is where if you've got someone pushing from the front, then make sure you're getting the support you need and describe what that support looks like. Say, right. I understand I'm the one that's the breadwinner at the moment. This could flip down the track. And the things that we need to talk about is how can I support you and how can you support me so that we both get our needs met.
Wonderful stuff. And that's exactly where I'm going, because my wife is an investor by nature. She is excited by trading. She's excited by every aspect of it, from stocks to Forex stuff to Bitcoin, crypto, and all that kind of stuff. She's very excited about it. And so I think we complement each other in for a long, you know, I've been the earner and she's been the investor, and that kind of, you know, putting money into it. So, but I know part of what you talk about, and part of there's a myth and about the roles of gender in investing and trading and all that kind of stuff. And so I want to talk about that, because a lot of guys would find it too macho to say, well, I trust my wife to the investment stuff because she's on that stuff. Roles, traditional old school roles, but that's the place I find myself in. And I think the world is changing with regard to that, but I just want to get your take on that. First of all, women are very competent traders quite often. And second of all, the kind of old school mentality that this is a man thing and that's I should be doing it, not her.
Yeah, isn't that interesting though, how long it takes for a societal mindset to diminish? It's fascinating to me how long these ideas take to wean themselves out and to become part of our history. I think there's a lot of good evidence to say that women are actually outperforming the men. So there are some famous studies, Brad Barber and Terence O'Dean. I ran a study into my own database at tradinggame.com.au, and that was with 2,000 traders, but Brad and Terence did a massive study, you know, hundreds of thousands of traders. And we looked at the trading results between genders. Oh, there were a whole heap of questions. The women are actually outperforming the blokes. It's fascinating, isn't it?
Yeah. Why? Yeah. What would account for that, though? What because, you know, and I don't want to get too political here, but we are the same. We are human beings. So what?
Yeah.
What make yeah. What would indicate that or be the factors that contribute to women outperforming men?
We've got a few things that are sounding like they're a flaw, but they're actually an advantage in the stock market. So one of the things is that we have a really big need to talk as females. I don't know if you've noticed that. Yeah, just a little. So we tend to want to talk and talk and talk. And what that can do is help us source the information from different sources. And that can be an advantage. We're also aware that it does feel like a male domain. It really, really does. And because of that, the females are taking more precautions. They're being more cautious. They're treading very softly. They're not that ego-driven, I can do this and it shall be done type of concept. We are more wary, and that leads to more conservative investments. Wow. The guys have got a few specifics that involve ego. They overtrade, they brag, they tend to jump in before they're ready. And we love that about you blokes. We really do. It helped get us out of the caves. But in the share market, it is a really tricky situation, because if you're jumping in on a whim because of gut feel, because your mate that you're playing golf with said you should go for it, all of that spells disaster. The best traders refer to a written trading plan. They've thought about it before. They've got every part of it listed. They've got a checklist, and they just follow like they're a little robot.
Well, so how does that play into the other part of it? Because you talk about getting started with the women, all that kind of stuff. Because on the other end, she tells me about every time something goes up, and she's excited about that. But and I'm always the first one to say, "Well, sell, come on, get out of before," because you know it's going to go down. It's just a matter of time. It's up now. Come on, sell. And she doesn't. And if it goes down and she tells me about it, I'm going to burn her on it. But generally, it will go back up. But that idea of her being more patient and long term and me being more, and I'm don't know if I'm like every male who will be in this, but
well, so far, it's working well. Yep.
Yeah. I mean, I am very scared when, okay, it's up. That's the time to be scared. We got to sell as soon as it's up. Talk to me about that impulse and how do I talk myself off that ledge?
Yeah. It is a situation where the market tends to redistribute money from the patient, from the impatient to the patient. So if you're impatient, you're willing to take those profits off the table, but it could have had a lot longer to run. So part of it is being a beginner trader. There is no doubt. We're so tempted to want to feel that win, to feel that, yes, we did that properly. I got a profit on that particular trade. But then over time, sometimes the 15 cents that you take off the table could have been $30 down the track. So you get bashed around in the markets. That's why you do need a support system. You need a mentor. You need someone who's been there before so that they can say, it's okay. Take a deep breath. Have a pause. Now, I don't know if you've done any yoga. I love yoga. One of the things that they say with yoga is that it's designed to help us pause. So before you get out of that pretzel-like position with your leg around the back of your head, just take a deep breath, relax into it, just feel that pain, and then release. That, I think, is very much like trading. If you've got that anxious type of I have to run feeling, just take a deep breath, just wait, okay, and then look at your trading plan, follow your trading plan, and then exit.
No, I definitely get why women are better at it now, because I've talked about that stuff all the time, because I know all that stuff. I count to 10 all the time, but I count to 10 when it's too late, because my emotional reactions happen like that. And by the time I think, count to 1 to 10, that I've already snapped. I've already made my emotional reaction well known to people or things. So, but women won't do. They're definitely more in touch and slower to just kind of hair trigger react to those kind of things. So I could definitely see why women would be better than men now that you've laid it out in that way. It must have been really devastating for you when you couldn't talk, because you're saying, power of speech is a good thing in this. How did you deal with that psychologically? I mean, the frustration of it.
Yeah, let's have a talk about that. There's always a time in your life where you get to the point and you wonder, do I push on or do I just give up? And I guess I'm speaking really personally with you here, because I feel like I know you so well, because you've put out so many beautiful resources. I lost the ability to speak during a lockdown where I couldn't even see my friends and I couldn't speak on the phone. I couldn't do a Zoom. It was devastating for me. So I used my book a lot. I've got a little book here. I write in it every single day. I tried to find quotes that inspired me. I relied on my husband and my children, my little girl, and sign language so that we could talk if we were out and I couldn't get to the book. I typed so that my family could read what I was writing on a laptop for our dinner party conversations. And I hung on to the thought that you hang on to an invincible summer in your soul. Rather than letting the outside world buffet you, there comes a time when you have to rely on the core within to determine your attitude. And I said to my husband, one day this will be an advantage. And you know what? It didn't even take that long for that day to happen. I'll tell you, I haven't even mentioned this, but I'll tell you what happened. I run a mentor program where I help people trade, and so does my business partner. We're co-founders. It's been running for 22 years. It's just been my life's work. It's huge. So I, because I've had a couple of health things in the past, seem to appeal to people who have disabilities and who want a spot of sunshine and in amongst trying to deal with their awful disability. I was approached just after I started to speak again, and things were pretty patchy. I could speak for maybe 15 minutes per day, from a man who had lost his tongue.
Wow.
He will never have a chance to speak, ever.
Wow.
So that, to me, I know we imbue meaning when we're in pain, and I do understand that, but finding that one person who I could inspire and who I could help and who was receptive and who understood what I was going through, it just made me think it's all going to be worthwhile one day. And that was that day. It really did inspire me to see how this person copes. There's always somebody worse off than you. There's always somebody dealing with a winter that you know nothing about. This is one of the things I really hope this pandemic does, is make us more open-hearted and receptive and empathic to people who have situations that are beyond their control. And I really do hope that happens. What do you think? Do you think that's likely, Matt?
I think you're a wonderful person. I think you're an optimist, and over-the-top optimist, because, and I applaud everything you just said. I mean, I agree with the idea of helping people. I mean, I try to do it, and I try not to make a big thing of it when I do it, but I don't see the world as getting more compassionate. I see, and maybe it's just jaded because of my age or whatever, I see the world is becoming less and less compassionate. I just tweeted something about this before, because I saw a guy who was very wealthy tweeting about the homeless people, and he was tweeting about, and people who live in poverty, and tweeting about them as if they are a major inconvenience in his life and an annoyance, and not offering a solution about what the homeless problem is and people on the streets, but just talking about how it ruins his life. It ruins his day to have to step over homeless people on the street. And I thought, man, that killed me. And that you know, you can not be, you can not be on the left or right or wherever you stand on this thing, but if you lose compassion for those people in any way, we're all lost in a lot of ways, especially if you want to spread that lack of compassion around. So I applaud what you're saying, and I appreciate that, and I hope it made a difference one at a time. But I'm not the optimist that you are.
Yeah, the one at a time is important. There is no doubt. I want to talk about that with the homeless situation, because I think a lot of people, when they have adequate, they actually forget what it's like to be in lack.
Yeah.
So there is a beautiful study about this, where after the war, where there were the concentration camps and people were in such lack, I mean dire lack, they did a study with people in Switzerland. They took some soldiers that wanted to earn a little bit of extra money. They hadn't quite worked out what career that they were going into. They were well fed. They were in medically good condition. They deprived them of food. Now, what they did, it was totally voluntary, okay? What they did is they studied these people. So to begin with, the first few three weeks were pretty rough. But after that, everything they discussed was about food. They talked about recipes. They talked about restaurants they were going to open up. They discussed dinner parties. They talked about every recipe that they could think of with ingredients, specific ingredients, what they felt like, what they tasted like, the whole visceral human experience of touch. These people could not stop talking about food. They showed them movies. They brought in dogs to entertain them. They had a circus come to perform. All of those distractions were an annoyance, because these guys wanted to just talk about food. That was the desperation of their lack. Not only did their IQ drop, which is something we have to be aware of, your IQ does go down when you're experiencing emotional distress, but everything that blocked them from their primary goal actually was considered ancillary. Now, this is something that I think most of us in our privileged situations can't even fully comprehend. That dire need, that level of pain that you go through when you're looking for a survival mechanism, it's something that I think we have to be aware of. You are you who you are because you've got what you've got around you, and because of where you were born, your environment. Take some of those things away, make it a little bit harder, and then we'll see who you really are. Fascinating to have as a concept, and I think most of us don't even realize what that is like.
Wow, that's pretty strong. Pretty strong stuff. But the idea too is that how do I put this? There are obviously we all can fall on hard times, but people who are chronically poor definitely have usually almost always have some real underlying issues that can be helped, and but you have to want the help. You have to kind of want prosperity and to get out of that cycle of poverty, right?
And have that goal. Mm-hmm.
But part of the problem, I think, is the belief that I'm not worthy. I don't deserve prosperity. And somehow another, it's like a guilt if I pursue a better life for myself. And I know a lot of poor people are trapped in that thing. And people who are of affluence, they look at that and they kind of acknowledge that, but they end up resenting that. And that's why this fellow tweeted out this kind of thing where these people on the street, I have to step over them on my way to the store, and that's an inconvenience to him. We kind of, the empathy runs out of it, but that there's no offering of how we can help those people develop the idea that they are worth, their life is worth something, and improving your lot and deserving things better, a better life for yourself is not something to be guilty over. We all deserve, you know, good things in our lives. How would you talk about that?
I think we need to think of that one person at a time. And I do think there are some wonderful resources that are coming out now to help us understand this broader concept. There's a Netflix show called Made. I don't know if you've seen that yet.
No, I have not.
I recommend it highly. It is fantastic.
Made, it's M-A-D-E?
M-A-I-D.
Okay, that's why, yes. I was asking. Okay.
Yes, good. So this lass is in an abusive situation with her husband. She escapes with her daughter. She becomes a maid, and it's about her struggle. I think you'd really love it because it talks about at the end that there's 7 different types of welfare that she had to be on to be able to get out of that situation. I'm hoping that as we become broader in society and we can open up our minds, that all we're going to have is 1 or 2 people to lead the way, making these big impacts, and it will have a ripple effect. That's what I hope.
I hope you're right.
I am an optimist, there is no doubt, but I do really think, I've seen with my disabled traders working towards getting their trading set up so they can get off their pension, off their welfare, the difference that makes and the ripple effect through their friends, their family, it's huge. You never know through your one act of kindness how far that will travel. Have you done any happiness projects yourself, Matt?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
I don't like to talk about them too much, but yes, I definitely get it. I'm definitely with you on all this stuff. And it's surprising, I guess, that I can remain a pessimist, but I guess because I look at the big picture more than I look at the one. And you're right, one-on-one does make a difference, and you can make a difference in the world, but it's harder to notice. And when you see this big picture and the media putting out all this kind of stuff, and then you have very affluent people like my friend tweeting out that people, it can change your perspective on these things. So that's why it's good to have you on and talk to you and get your perspective on it, because at least for for the next day or so, I'll be thinking about what you said and maybe ruminating on it and incorporating that into my mindset. So
I've got a couple of little things you can try if you're after a project.
Sure,
you know, people who've got a psychology background, we do like to set homework. So here's something I'd love you to try, and I would love everybody listening to try. Aim to give one compliment per day to a new person for a week. It can be somebody that's come into the lift. It can be a workmate that you haven't spoken to that much before. Give one compliment. Now, notice the effect on them, but notice the effect on you, because that giving attitude can really perk you up. And if you're after level two in this game of kindness, I did a happiness project of sending out a card per day for 1 year a few years ago. And it was a fantastic year. After the first 2 or 3 months, of course, I ran out of with people that I knew. I couldn't think of anybody. Who can I send a card out today to? So I was sending it out to waiters. I was sending it out to people who'd help me in shops, the guy that changed my tires. It was fantastic. And the level of love that I received back was amazing. It made me dig deep into my past. It made me think from a gratitude perspective, who have I not given recognition to? And I was astounded with the impact, not only on the people, but on me, because sometimes we need to have that awareness of personal benefit before we pursue a particular behavior. I bet you you'd find a compliment today. Huh. Bet you you would.
Yeah, you just affected me in a very big way, because as I'm listening to you speak, I know I do give out a lot of compliments, but, and this is important, I don't give them out to people in my everyday life. It's more like in my business stuff and the stuff we do here, where I'm thinking about like people I perform with, the people at who come to see us all the time, and my wife, my stepson. I mean, people in my life, I generally am a little more stingy with those compliments. And
Isn't that interesting? Yeah.
Thank you for that. That's pretty cool. Pretty cool stuff. So, but what were we talking about? Poverty and stuff. So this leads to a very important question I'm sure you get all the time, and I'm interested in what the answer is, and I'm going to try to put it as simply as possible. How much does somebody need to start improving their lot from a financial perspective and start to invest? Is there a certain dollar amount? Can you start from nothing and being on welfare and get out by investing?
Yeah, look, I know a lot of my competitors would say yes, because they're coming at it from a different angle. But the first step with discipline is to save. That's really got to be the first step. Just remember, though, you can't ever save your way to extreme wealth. It's impossible. You do have to invest in either business, in real estate, in the share market, in the stock market. They're really the three main vehicles. It's got to be done down the track. So if you're starting from nothing, you need to educate yourself first. Read some good books. Read the books that not only inspire you but teach technique, because you do want some level of technique before you begin trading. So there's really the three components. You need a good trading system, which involves your entry, your exit, and how much money to put into each trade. You need trading psychology. So this is what you're doing now, is straight up psychology. I mean, this is really self-improvement, because rarely will your level of your bank account exceed your level of self-development. And then the last component after you are trading is maintenance. So to make sure that you're making that money do as much as you possibly can, and that you're being loyal to your system. So you can't really do this if you have zero until you start getting educated. So educate, save, and get yourself a trading plan.
That's all fair enough. Thank you for that. But the question really, and I hate to oversimplify this, because it is a simpleton type of question, but how much do we need to have saved before you can begin trading? And with some degree of confidence that you're not going to blow your $20,000, $50,000, whatever you have saved as a starting point. How much is a good starting point for people?
Look, as at the minimum side, you're probably looking at about the $5,000 mark.
Oh, that's so not you. Bad.
you do have to realize that this is an investment vehicle. Like if you're looking to buy a property, you'd need a lot more. Most people start with the $15,000 to $20,000 mark and up from there. So the more you've got, the better off you're going to be. You can spread yourself into more positions and it will give you a learning curve. You don't want to pop everything on black with this. You want to actually have a few different positions so that you can see how they work. And you definitely want to know how to set a stop loss. This is where it will take you out of that trade if it shows adverse signs. You want it to be automatic, put on through your brokerage system so that it takes you out of the equation as a human. We are so fallible. We will second guess ourselves. We will make that argument that no, it'll go up. It really will. I'll just hang on for a little longer. We have our egos just in the wrong spot with trading. I think it's far better to be 100% mechanical. If that system triggers off in your brokerage platform, then it will take you out of the trade. And that tends to be a better way to approach things.
Right. And we definitely are going to be reactive to it. So the idea, and I know your focus on education is an important part of it, but it's like, when are you ready as far as from the educational perspective? Will you be self-sufficient from the, I'm going to trade by myself on after a certain given time, a year, 6 months, whatever it is of training that you would go through? Or do you always have to have a mentor or somebody, a consultant in your life that you can bounce things off, that you can trust and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it does help to have a trading friend at least. There is no doubt. somebody that at least understands your mindset, what you're trying to achieve, to check up, to see, hey, I did this, what do you think? It would be great. But in terms of, I learned how to trade alone, in terms of the actual physical part of it, you can do it yourself. You just have to be really prepared to learn from your mistakes. I've got a trading plan template that I give away for free, and that course that you've done actually, Matt, through tradinggame.com.au. Register for free. Grab that course first. Have a little dip your toe into the water and see if this is the type of area for you. That'll give you a broad perspective about what it takes to be a trader. So once you've started, perhaps I'll have a look at the trajectory. Once you've started with trading and putting actual money into the market, then you can have more of an idea about who you are and how that will go for you. A lot of people start with a demo account. They give you play money. You know, maybe they'll assign $30,000, you know, fake money.
Right.
You trade with that. You can trade with that for a few months, work out how it all comes together. A lot of people feel a little blocked by the technology, but heck, if you can handle using a computer, you can handle the technology. It's just becoming familiar with it. Ideally, once you've got money in the market, your goal would be to break even in your first year. That is a huge goal for the majority of people, to come out flat, because some of your positions will lose, some will make money. You want to come out flat. If you put 20,000 in by the end of the year, you want to be able to take 20,000 out. Now, that year is your learning year. You will learn so much in your first 20 trades. I even suggest to my traders, don't change your trading plan until you've done 20 trades, because otherwise you're tweaking and you're using sort of that whole idea of that scientific discovery. You change one variable at a time. Use that as your guide so that you've got a really sound foundation, how you are as a trader, how you're reacting to the market, and what your trading plan can produce. So stay loyal for 20 trades and then look to see what you can tweak.
Interesting stuff. Because it almost sounds like, because I'm, and you know, I'm a simpleton, but when it comes to financial stuff, I admit that. But I've always been under the impression that there are good decisions and bad decisions, and not knowing how to make a good decision or a bad decision is crucial. It sounds to me like you're saying there are no real bad decisions.
Yeah, you can get out of it. You know, it's different. I used to be in an office with the guys that ran a betting magazine for horses. It was a great environment because we had guys that were professional gamblers and we had little old me. So I did notice that, yeah, it was fascinating to see. I did notice there was a lot of staff turnover. They were recording all of the races. And I said to the manager, give me the name of the person who I can kind of model myself on. Who would you say would be a good gambler? Because trading's not like gambling. You can get out of a trade halfway. These horses, once you've backed one, they run all the way. You can't get out of your bet, you know. He introduced me to this complete introvert, Steve. Steve was making so much money on the track. He was quite the disciplined person. We compared notes. He loved that I had a trading plan because he had a plan to be able to make money out of the horses. The thing that I thought was hilarious was after he realized that I could exit out of a position halfway through that trade, I didn't have to wait for 10 years. I could just pull the pin if the thing wasn't going in the direction I wanted. He was just like, what? You can get out? If you're wrong, you can get out? What black magic is this? So he became a trader. Now, interesting to see that the lessons that he'd learned actually translated well to trading. So the lessons you've learned, Matt, with learning scales, learning the basics of being able to be a musician, being able to have that drudge and that grind of practice, 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 and reveling in nuance instead of novelty. Because at a certain level with music, correct me if I'm wrong, but at a certain level, you're just playing with tiny, tiny little changes and then the end result is completely different. Am I right?
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you're not taking on a brand new instrument. You're actually using your one instrument to make those tiny changes and to have a big impact. Same with trading. I've been trading since 1990. Like, oh my goodness, it has been a long, long haul. It's been the only thing I've ever stuck to this long in my life.
Now actually, I would have thought you'd probably been born in 1990, but that's a discussion for another time. Man.
Did you just do that to get your compliment in for the day? Well done.
No, I'm sincere in that. It's just you don't look old enough to be trading since 1990, which means you have to have been an adult by 1990, right?
Correct. Oh. You have to trade when you're past 18. I had a couple of dabbles prior to when I started when I was 20. But prior to that, I had my sister's boyfriend who helped me with my very first trade. He invested in a company that I'd never heard of. I made $5,000 as a 15-year-old in this one trade, that's why I was hooked.
I could see how you would be hooked on that kind of stuff. And I know that's not an uncommon story of young people who are entrepreneurs. So that begs the question. Can you be born with the skill of being good with money and investing can it be a natural born gift?
For some, yes. I know this is probably not the popular answer, but
right.
To be open with you, some people are spectacular from the get-go. Oh my gosh. We trained this one guy, he blew our head off. He had never touched the markets. He flew over to Singapore to meet with me and Chris Tate for a dinner. Like, hang on, wow, this guy really does want mentoring. Everything he's done has been like he's got the Midas touch. It has just turned to gold. It's been fun to be able to guide him and to make those tweaks, make those slight nuanced changes. But he was ready. He was ready, ready, ready. 99% of the time, though, that is not going to be you. It won't be you. Really won't. No, there's always one Bill Gates. There's always a freak, should we say. But the majority of the time we've all had to slash our way through the jungle and, you know, get that machete out and cut down those vines. So I do think that that is an unachievable, unrealistic goal for the majority of people. People quit too soon with this. If I look at my own behavior, it took me 3 years to actually even get back to where I started. 3 years to break even. At any stage in those 3 years, if I had have quit, I would have been stuffed. You know, I wouldn't have had the lifestyle that I've got now. I wouldn't be supporting my family. I wouldn't have my children in private school. I wouldn't have my pick of areas to live. I dread to think if that younger Louise had have quit, where I'd be now.
Well, when I hear any story like yours, I kick myself for ever complaining about anything. I often find myself complaining, and my chief complaint in life is that I complain too much. It's because I have nothing to complain about. My life is perfect. I have good health. I have, the life I want. I'm doing what I love. So I really shouldn't complain about anything. And then I hear a story like yours and I get really like, how dare you complain?
Do you know, though, I wonder if we can talk about that for a moment, Matt, because I think a lot of us are comfortable, and why would we interfere with our life by taking on a new challenge? The only reason why is because you have got something extra that you want out of life.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that purpose, that calling, if you like, that is really what has to become foremost in all of our minds before we get out of our own comfort zone. So no matter where you're starting from, like if you're starting from where you are right now, for you to go on to your next goal, you have to have some golden thread pulling you in that direction. So it could be that your friends have started to upgrade their lifestyle. Often that's a FOMO type of situation. Yeah. It could be that maybe somebody in your family needs extra help and you have to pursue something to be able to provide that help. Helping other people is often a good motivation. If you're happy with what you've got, though, hey, keep doing it. You know, like that question, where are you going to be in 5 years' time? If you can genuinely say doing exactly what I am doing now, kudos to you, my friend.
Hopefully you'll be alive in 5 years from now. Yeah. I mean, at my age, this is a general, and with the number of lifelong friends I've had that have been dropping like flies over the last 10 or 20 years, and even recently, it's a genuine concern. But in some ways, I hate to make this a philosophical thing, but in some ways, the fact that death is looming, it's just not that far down the road, it makes you more inspired to do things and kind of motivates you more. It's like, there's a lot left I want to do with my life. It's a good thing that ugly thing called death is there staring me in the face, because without it, I probably wouldn't get out of bed. But with it there, I know I got things to do in my life, and there is some purpose for me being here. I want to make a kind of a disclaimer here, because I don't want people in the audience thinking we're giving out financial advice here, but I need to ask you about what's going on here in America. I'm not sure if you probably have to be aware of it, but due to COVID and due to what's going on here, they're calling it a supply chain crisis, and how that affects people's decisions and investing. And is it, in your view, is it a long-term thing? And what is the real cause of it? Because people are asking me, because I have friends who actually think I'm smart and think I'm like well-informed, and they're like, what is this really all about? And I don't think I'm getting the straight answer anywhere. I can't really find out. I mean, you could say COVID caused supply back to wherever, lack of workers, lack of shipping containers, quarantines, whatever it is. But I'm confused. Can you help me, enlighten me on what's going on?
I wish I could. No. As a trader, all we do is we look at the signals, we take the signals, and we don't actually question why. I know that does sound really strange, looking at an outcome. Yeah. So I keep on hearing these things. Oh, it's because of China. Yeah, I have no idea. The majority of the time, I don't even know what the investment companies that I'm investing in do. I have no idea. They just give me a signal and I trade it.
If you don't know why, how can you predict how long it will last or what the outcome, because you just talked about being on outcome. How can you predict the outcome if you don't know what the cause is?
Yeah. Look, a lot of people think we try to read the future as traders. I have no idea how long something will go up. I traded, my best trade last year was a tiny little company. It was miniature when it started, gave me all the right signals. I just followed it up and up and up. And as it went up, I moved my stop loss up. Eventually, when it tipped over, I got out and I bought it. I bought an extra house. I have no idea. I still don't really know what they do. I think we have to be really careful about assuming that we understand causality. So we know that there's the two concepts. So you've got causality, which is if something happens here, it causes this reaction. And then the other school of thought is correlation. So maybe you were going to go and get better anyway, even if you hadn't have gone to the doctor and they gave you antibiotics. It's just a correlation. I think we really have to be careful about it. As humans, we are questing for a narrative. We want to understand the reason behind everything. We think we're God with that. We really do. We think we can have this ultimate knowledge about how the world comes together. But the majority of the time, we have no idea.
That's so true.
I always think it's better to be a bit of a scared mouse than to be one of those buffaloes. I really think that that humble view where you don't have to know everything, you don't have to know what causes this, what causes that, is a better way to invest. Just take the signals. If your stop tells you to get out, then get out.
Wow, that's a heavy revelation to somebody like me, because, and I'm sure there are a lot of people like me who are under the impression that and I know a lot of guys who think in terms of get rich quick ideas, you know, I'm going to make this big splash on something. Look at it as like, I have to be kind of predictive about and taking causality into effect and all that stuff into account, and kind of be able to predict things that are going to happen in the world and make investments based on ideas of predictions that could be right or wrong. But I think a lot of people are under that impression, just as I was until you just gave me that eye-opening moment. And as you were saying that, I'm thinking, does that apply across the board in life or into other things? It's not just trading we're talking about. Unfortunately, it does become a philosophical conversation then, because I'm thinking about what you're just saying and how that applies to other things in my life. It's like, wow, what a heavy moment that was. Thank you.
You know, there was a wonderful trader, Jesse Livermore, and he lived over 100 years ago. He wrote, the nom de plume wrote the book, so about Jesse's life. Jesse said, you can never know how far that share will go. That stock, how dare we try to predict? And I've taken a lot of credibility from that. I really have. I've gone, you know, you've got that tiny little view. You only know what affects your corner of the world. Let's just follow along. Let's just see where it all leads to.
Are you having a supply shortage where you are?
Oh my gosh, yes. It's hideous. We've got a big hardware company called Bunnings, and Bunnings is the key hardware firm. Everybody gets their sausage sizzle on a Saturday. We go to Bunnings. Bunnings have got like total lumber issues. They've sold out of screws. We're having to actually alter some of the things that we put into. My husband does property development, you see, so that affects his side more than my side in terms of investment. We're having to consider other type of aspects for our kitchens, that type of thing. Wow. So yeah, it is. It's a really big issue.
We are very self-centered, and you probably know this about America, but we just think the world begins and ends on our shores, and basically, and Australia, who cares about that unless we're going there on holiday or something. But I just, you know, listening to you talk, I got to get to Australia before I die. I have to.
Oh, come over. Just hold off though, just for a little bit. Let us get out all of our.
Yeah. It doesn't sound like a fun place to be now.
No, it's not fantastic. But when you do, come to Melbourne and come and see Chris and I. We'd love that.
Oh yeah, I would definitely love that. I mean, it's been on my bucket list for a long time. I don't know, because the reason is, I know why. It's just because of the endless flight that it is. Just the travel alone it scares me away from
it's a very, very long way. There is no doubt, but we will be definitely warmly welcoming you when you make that trip.
The destination is definitely probably worth the trip, but the trip is scary. Yesterday, and I don't know if you're prepared to talk about, and I know I asked Chris about money and what it all really means, and I still have not got a good answer that I can feel solid on. But yesterday I had a historian on, and we were talking about Nixon taking America off the gold standard, and I said, you know, because we were talking about the gold rush, and I said, what gave gold its value in the first place. I mean, people saw a shiny rock and we decided we were going to base our money off of this shiny rock. Why? I mean, what made it so special? And she started talking about Nixon and the gold standard because something had to back money. I said, well, nothing is backing our money now. So why did something have to back our money then? I'm just confused about the value. It's just a piece of paper that we are agreeing has value and assuming that there's something behind it, but there's nothing. Please help me understand.
Yeah, I'm hearing you. We are at a critical juncture in history. You know, you think back to the Romans where they had little rocks around their neck and you could push out the middle of the rock and that could be payment, and the rest of it you'd have as a necklace. I mean, it's very, very peculiar how we actually come to these conclusions as humans. I think with crypto, we've got a very different line coming up, and we are at a very important juncture with the way that the monetary markets are coming together. The crypto market being unregulated, there is a lot of pressure from societal forces, the bankers, to bash crypto down and to keep it where it belongs in their view. I'm using inverted commas there, because they don't think it has a place. The thing is, though, we have had derivatives of derivatives for as long as the share market has been operating. So I think that there is a lot of vested interest in keeping crypto down. I'm not a crypto expert, there is no doubt. However, I think it has its place and it is something that will be the next step. Ecuador's taken it on as their currency. They're able to put ATM transactions through crypto, any of the point of service transactions, you can actually pay for it with crypto. The president gave crypto to all of the citizens, and I think it's fascinating to watch. So it will be interesting to see how that comes, where that decoupling from gold, where that actually all leads to. I don't think there's an answer to that. I really don't. I think
are you not nervous at all? Because you're right, and I do think there is a concerted effort by people who, you know, the old money, you know, banking system to keep crypto down, but without having regulation on something, there is always a potential for just capitalism to run way too far of its bound without any regulation at all, and for some really bad things to happen. Are you not nervous at all?
I'm definitely concerned about the lack of regulation, and they're moving towards it now. The first step is that a lot of those mandates for the major funds is where they say you're allowed to invest this much in this type of instrument, this much in that instrument. Those mandates have now started to involve crypto. So they've said you can have 5% of this portfolio in the crypto market. So that is starting to legitimize things when the big players are actually looking to invest in it. And I'm hoping the next step will be some sort of form of regulation. It's cowboy city here, isn't it? It's just crazy now. It's very reminiscent of the old bucket shops in the stock market back 200 years ago, 100 years ago, where people could get ripped off big time and there was nothing to stop other than reputation, people's life savings going down the tube. So now it's more important than ever that you look at your financial thermostat, you develop a good wealth mindset, and you work out how much of your money goes into different vehicles. I think the people who are going to be left behind, the people who are going to struggle, are the ones, firstly, that aren't open-minded enough to look at new vehicles, but secondly, people who think that new vehicle is the best thing since sliced bread, and then they put too much money into it, backing the wrong horse.
Right. Yeah, it's a scary time, and I'm scared more for people, workaday people who are not even in the market or investing in any way, and being subject to the mistakes or overstepping a bound of greedy people and stuff like that can affect the whole world, even people who are just content working week to week, paycheck to paycheck, and not involved in that, and how that fallout can really destroy their lives. And so that's something to be, again, you're an optimist. You don't, this stuff doesn't keep you up at night. But me, a pessimist, I'm thinking the world is always, one step
on the precipice. Yeah. Yeah. I think it's incentive though. You know, years ago, we didn't have to have this broad level of knowledge. We could specialize in our career and we thought we'd have a job for life and it would suit us all the way through to that golden watch at the end.
Oh my God, what an important idea. And it's something that I've just kind of had this epiphany this week and talking to a young musician who has had a great, great run of from the time she's 12 to 17 now of playing in a particular spot that made her famous. But, you know, life can change. And don't think that Grafton Street is always going to be there. It's not going to be there. I can't tell you how many opportunities and gigs that I fell into in my life that thought, well, this is it. I would be happy playing this gig forever, and it's always going to be there. And winter would come, and I would plan on my summers at these venues, and then something happened to stir that up, and that opportunity is no longer there. So that idea of permanence and that life is going to change, and you have to be adaptable to all of it, it's just so critical now, and it becomes more critical as the world becomes more complicated. So thank you.
And there's opportunity in that. You right. know, there's absolutely, if you have a look at the major turning points in your life, they wouldn't have just happened. You wouldn't have just slid into them. There would have been an impetus, a reason why you made that 2-degree difference and ended up in a different place. So I think that that's part of the fun of it.
Well, it's an hour, and I don't want to keep you talking too long, but with that comment, I just have to say, you don't talk like a financial person when you're talking about stuff like that, because there is this essence of, or this idea that there's something bigger out there, and there's something bigger and grander than us, and that's not common in the financial world. Or is it? I'm just mistaken and have the wrong
impression. No, I think you're right. Yeah.
Well, it just doesn't seem like a common mix. It's almost like being an artist and a business person don't necessarily mix a lot of times. Being a financial person and having some sense of something bigger than the human condition is not necessarily, they don't go together like peanut butter and jelly. I don't even know if they have peanut butter and jelly in Australia. I don't know. But you get the idea. Anyway, I appreciate your time here. I don't want to keep you talking because I'm very aware that you're just beginning again. I appreciate your time. What are we going to tell people? Is it still we're going to start them with the five audio little mini course that we started?
Yeah, come and visit me at tradinggame.com.au and register your details so we can stay in touch. I'll give you my Trading Made Simple 5-part audio course, and you'll also get my trading plan template so that you can start trading like a professional. So tradinggame.com.au.
Great. And the link is in the description for Make It Easy for People. Now, I need your advice on something. As I mentioned, I've taken the course, but I think you're fine with me saying this, that I realized that I want my wife to take this course. Now, the advice I need from you is how I get her to take the course, because she, you know, she listens to the people she listens to, and not so influenced by me saying you just got to take this course. But I've gotten this thing; it's valuable. I found value in it. I just don't. It's not for me because I'm a podcaster musician. I want her to take it. Got any advice for me on how I get her to take that first step and listen?
Yeah, get her curious. So I just interviewed this chick. She seems to know what she's on about. Oh, hey, yeah. I'd love it if you could evaluate this for me.
Yeah. Okay. And I'll also tell her that she's turned on by bald men. So you better listen to what she has to say.
Exactly. There's so much we'd have in common.
Yeah. Well, enjoy your summer. I'm getting ready for winter. You're getting ready for summer. I appreciate you stopping by. I wish you good health and great things and continued success. And thank you for being part of this and the extraordinary, extraordinary pearls of wisdom you've shared with me and my audience tonight. Thank
you
very much.
It's a pleasure and an honor. Thanks so much.
Same here. Bye for now. Oh, come on. Louise Bedford, folks, tradinggame.com/AU, not AU as in New York, AU, no, the letter A in U. Link's in the description. It's right there. Come on, you know what I'm saying. Anyway, this is not the end of the week for me. I know it would be on a normal week, but I have at least one show tomorrow. I'm taping another one tomorrow, which I may end up playing back. I'm not sure when we're going to schedule for. I've been excited to be having it. I've got Paul Provenza. I'm going to be interviewing him at noon tomorrow, and then for playback at another time. And then tomorrow night, the Boudreaux's from Los Angeles, California, foot stomping guitar box music. Should be a very interesting program, you know, about building guitars into cigar boxes, which I know a lot of my guitar player friends would argue with me is not doable, not a good thing, but they're wrong. We'll find out about it tomorrow at 8 p.m. Till then, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for joining me. Have a great rest of your night, and bye for now.